everyone. Welcome to City Talk. I'm Thermise Bevel. City Council President Ceasar Mitchell was all smiles at the Atlanta Business League's appreciation luncheon, and he has one more award to add to his trophy case, the Catalyst Award.
President Mitchell was honored at the league's 36th annual CEO Appreciation Luncheon for his unwavering dedication in fostering the growth of minority businesses.
It's really great to be here with so many wonderful people, to be here with the Atlanta Business League, which has really been a wonderful Atlanta stalwart organization for so many years.
The organization says Mitchell has shaped and developed the community's business force by crafting legislation facilitating economic revitalization in underdeveloped areas and by authorizing measures to create four of the city's 10 tax allocation districts. Mitchell says the league is a prominent group with such remarkable history, and for that reason, he is deeply humbled to receive an award from an organization that has done so much for the city of Atlanta.
The Atlanta Business League is a business organization that really has been focused on helping to develop and network small and African-American-owned businesses, but really all businesses in the Atlanta community for a very, very long time, for generations. And so the work that they do really continues to this day. The leadership under Leona Barr Davenport and a wonderful board certainly has made a difference in our city.
The Atlanta Business League was established in 1933. It has implemented programs and initiatives that have produced new businesses and millions of dollars in revenue. And some of those who were at the Atlanta Business League's appreciation luncheon were also here at City Hall when President Mitchell hosted an information session on the Equal Business Opportunity Update for the new Atlanta Falcons Stadium. Construction of the $1.2 billion stadium is underway and they need contractors. Mitchell says this session was a chance to learn more about the opportunities available with the stadium project and how it can serve as an economic engine for Atlanta.
So this really was about getting information, but also I wanted business owners to have the opportunity to have what I call the eyeball-to-eyeball experience. And that's networking and relationship building. And so I think we kind of help businesses kind of see a clearer path towards that objective as well.
Representatives from the Atlanta Falcons and the City of Atlanta's Office of Contract Compliance gave presentations. The Falcons' plan for the design and construction of the facility includes a fair chance for small, minority, and women-owned companies.
It is my hope to do this on a quarterly basis. I've gotten the commitment from the Falcons organization to do this on a regular basis. So that not only new information becomes available, but that the public can see the progress of the inclusion of small businesses in this project.
Business owners asked questions and gave feedback. Many of them are excited about the possibility of providing professional services for the stadium. For more information, you can log on to their website. More travelers at Hartsfield-Jackson Atlanta International Airport are now connected. City Talk's Troy Danicus explains how service for airport customers just got faster.
Welcome to the airport's launch of its newest customer service amenity and one of the mayor's key initiatives to build upon Atlanta's status as one of the world's top airports.
Free Wi-Fi will now be available to the more than 95 million passengers that pass through the world's busiest and most efficient airport every single year.
Mayor Reed joined airport officials to launch improved and free wireless internet service at Hartsfield-Jackson.
We're resolving what has been the number one complaint among guests of Hartsfield-Jackson.
According to recent surveys, 30% of complaints by airport customers cited the lack of free wireless internet access. They also wanted faster speeds.
We've enhanced our Wi-Fi network to make it compatible with the latest web-enabled devices. The large majority of the travelers have smartphones, tablets, laptops, or a combination of all three. And we made the decision that they should be able to access all of them at no charge.
15,000 users will be able to log on at the same time, and the new and improved service boosts download speeds to 5 megabits per second, up from 1 megabit. Passengers like Simon here, who spent his time streaming music, should find the speeds comparable to other airports.
I know some airports don't have like very good Wi-Fi, and this one's pretty good actually, so I'm satisfied with it.
Airport officials say the new system will also soon deliver a customer rewards program based on a passenger's location near airport retail stores. For City Talk, I'm Troy Danicus.
Airport officials are taking the hassle out of international flights. 74 automated passport control kiosks will now assist passengers in concourses E and F. Flyers can scan their passports and answer the customs declaration questions without waiting in line. Customs and border security officers then check receipts and passports to finalize the inspection. The new system promises to save the busy traveler precious time.
We're expecting a 20 to 40% efficiency in moving through our process. This machine allows the travelers to do the mechanical part of our process, and then the officers will be able to focus on the actual individual.
It's important to note, however, that only travelers with electronic system for travel authorization approval will be allowed to use the kiosk. A new inbound roadway is easing congestion at the airport. The new three-lane road will serve southbound drivers heading to the domestic terminal. The project is part of a complete roadwork upgrade that is designed to improve travel times and safety. Work on the $60 million improvement project will be completed by the end of the year. On the agenda, the Atlanta City Council passed legislation to sell the Atlanta Civic Center. Council members voted 10-4 in favor of the measure. Invest Atlanta will seek bids from developers to sell the facility and its 18 acres. Councilman Kwanza Hall says the right project could create 2,000 jobs in the old Fourth Ward. Some development options for the location include housing, retail, office space, or perhaps a hotel. Councilmember Joyce Shepherd joins Leadership Atlanta's class of 2014. Members of Leadership Atlanta explore community issues, examine themselves as leaders, and build relationships of trust and mutual understanding. Through retreats, seminars, service projects, and discussion groups, they work to strengthen Atlanta's communities. Shepherd says she's anticipating a robust exchange of ideas. 77 business and civic leaders make up the class of 2014. Constituents had a chance to communicate their concerns to service providers at a town hall meeting with Councilman Ivory Lee Young Jr. Young heard firsthand from residents about their issues, and he also gave updates on initiatives and projects across District 3, as well as the city's fiscal year budget. Young says constituent input is vital to elevating quality of life, improving service delivery, and drafting legislation that will have a positive impact. And there was a lot of good news.
Certainly all of the new investments coming with Public Works that were announced tonight, real exciting. And we have some new parks and other things that are coming, new programs that are coming through our planning department. So a lot of good things to talk about.
Every time I come, it's very, very informative. You find out who do you need to talk to in terms of what may be going on in your community. And one thing I can say that every time that I've come to the meeting, if I had a problem and I talked to individuals as well as Councilman Young, they have corrected the problem within less than 10 days.
The town hall meeting was an opportunity to bring city departments to the community to share information about important city issues. A new report highlights solar energy in Atlanta. Councilwoman Natalie Archibong and Sustainability Director Denise Quarles joined Environment Georgia at the Hanna Solar headquarters for the release of a report that provides a first of its kind comparative look at the growth of solar power in major American cities. The report found there is more than 200 times as much solar photovoltaic capacity installed in the U.S. today compared to 2002. Archibong says she is looking forward to exploring policies that will make Atlanta a solar leader in the South and across the country.
One of the takeaways from that study is that a goal has been set that by 2020, we'll have 10% solar power within the city of Atlanta as our basic power source. I support that, and as the chair of the City Utilities Committee, I'm here to learn more about solar power.
Atlanta has a citywide sustainability initiative. It's called Power to Change. It represents our residents, our businesses, our nonprofits, academia, and government. And it focuses on things from growing business to water to energy management. So the efforts for a program like Environment Georgia really fit squarely into the city's goals.
The city's sustainability director added that as a pollution-free energy source, solar energy is helping Atlanta progress towards both its environmental and economic goals. Councilmember Kwanzaa Hall represents the heart of Atlanta, including the Midtown section of the city. And he was a panelist for a Midtown Alliance discussion about what makes a great urban experience and what are the elements of an exciting city.
John Moores moderated a discussion where four panelists with different perspectives had a thought-provoking conversation about qualities that make a great urban city.
We have not been given a list of questions, so it's going to be really interesting to be kind of off the top of our heads and having to improv our answers to respond to things that may be from the left and from the right, but all related to the urban experience here, what the past has been, where we are now, and where we can go.
Midtown Alliance wants us to envision an environment that is beautiful, clean, and safe with walkable streets and lots of transportation options.
It's an opportunity to have a dialogue from the development community, from hospitality, from arts and culture, from architects, and from elected officials about what makes a city great, what creates that deep personal connection between people and place.
A great urban city also has accessible parks and green space, successful businesses, convenient retail, and boundless choices for enjoyment.
The fine dining, I think, is wonderful, and there's always something to do and places to go, so I think it's great.
Midtown Alliance has several programs and projects that take a comprehensive approach to urban planning and development. Councilwoman Keisha Bottoms joins the fight against blight in Southwest Atlanta. Bottoms says blight influences our surroundings, impacts the value of nearby properties, and affects safety, health, and quality of life. The cleanup effort focused on the Campbellton Road corridor.
This is huge for this community. It's just about reclaiming it one block at a time. This used to be just a vital commercial district. And there's still so many people who love this community and are invested in this community, and we just need to give it some attention.
Those who pitched in say they want residents in Southwest Atlanta to have a safe community.
Let's go, Dragons! Yeah!
They take their kickball seriously on the south side of town, and we'll talk about activities and programs available through the Office of Recreation. Stay with us. Anika Holder is the Executive Director of the Office of Recreation. She's with us today. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you so much for having me.
As the new Recreation Director, what is your vision for the department?
My vision for the department is to provide comprehensive services for all Atlantans. As you know, our agency focuses very heavily on youth development, but certainly with more than 5.2% of the city's land that's managed by the Parks Department, we're very well poised to provide programming for all in various areas, including fitness and wellness, health, outdoor adventure, and community engagement.
Youth development is a priority of Mayor Reeves. How has your department contributed to developing Atlanta's kids?
Our department is working very hard every single day to ensure that we're developing kids here in the city of Atlanta. We run a very comprehensive after-school program at 14 locations, four in conjunction with the Boys and Girls Club. There is Camp Best Friends happening right now at 24 sites across the city. Our outdoor pools are open. We run swim teams. There's athletics. We have a comprehensive teen program where we are providing kids with a number of opportunities, including career exploration, SAT preparation, college tours, and really just ensuring that they're getting outside of their community and learning what this great city has to offer.
What are some of the recent accomplishments of the Office of Recreation?
So we just wrapped up our school year, and we're really excited to say that we serve 1,697 youth in our after-school program. And really, to take a step back, 3 years ago, the total number served was 848. So we're certainly growing each year, and we're very proud of that number.
Tell us about some of the new programs you're offering for residents and visitors.
So this summer is a really exciting time, and we're going to continue to grow every day. So this spring, we launched Tots and Rec. It's a programming for our young people, 5 and younger. And so we had a very successful T-ball for Tots season, and certainly parents should visit our website and find more information about Tots and Rec. However, this summer, our outdoor pools are open, 12 of, you know, great pools, and two locations, South Bend and Mosley Park, we're offering free senior swim 2 mornings a week. And at Grand Park, we piloted a new program where we're doing early bird lap swim every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from 7 a.m. to 9 a.m.
What can we expect next from the Office of Recreation?
You can expect a lot. We're really excited about this summer, but certainly we're planning for the fall. This summer, parents can engage their kids in structured free activities at 5 parks across the city. And we encourage them to visit our website to learn more about our Kids at Play program. We want to get kids off the couch and into our parks. And also for adults, there's going to be an increase in our fitness opportunities, more fitness classes, more programming, more equipment. You can also expect us to provide more services for our older residents, our seniors. We're certainly looking at more activities to get them more involved in the community and ensure that we're engaging them. So by all means, we encourage Atlantans to visit that website and learn more about what we're doing.
Anika Holder, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
And we're celebrating yet another great installation of Atlanta Streets Alive.
The rain didn't stop these guys from taking it to the streets. And
it takes all of us working together to make a successful school experience for our students.
Some lucky fifth graders have brand new wheels to cruise around on. Back in a moment. Another Atlanta Streets Alive, this time at the intersection of Peachtree Street and Martin Luther King Jr. Drive. Atlanta Streets Alive, a festival on the streets of Atlanta, closes roads and opens the streets to people who want to be outside. Over 60,000 attendees experienced an afternoon of car-free community fun.
The Atlanta Bicycle Coalition, what we're trying to do in the city is make biking accessible for everyone. We want it to be something that's just built into the culture and part of the everyday activity that we all can participate in the city that we love.
Council members Hall, Dickens, and Norwood were out and about. Hall kicked off the Great Atlanta Bicycle Parade, then rode his bike north, catching up with District 2 neighbors and international visitors. Hall is proud to be the founding Atlanta City Council sponsor of Atlanta Streets Alive. It all started 4 years ago on Edgewood Avenue.
I knew that you all were closing the streets in downtown Atlanta today so I could do a bike ride. I'm not letting the rain deter me. In Texas, we're glad to get rain. I'm Rod Dealis, a Texas State Senator from Houston. I love Atlanta. I think it's a great idea that you're closing these streets to get people excited about cycling, about losing weight, about healthy living. And I can't wait until the next one comes around. I'll show up in Atlanta again.
After school programs, internships, educational summer programs. These are some of the key ingredients that offer great potential to enrich the life of a young person. But the question is, where can parents find programs that provide lasting educational enrichment for their children? Well, Councilmember Andre Dickens may have the answer.
Have you ever wondered how to land an internship with a law office, or learn how money is made, or how to score a free day at the Atlanta Zoo? Well, wonder no more, because the City of Atlanta has a website that provides information on all of that and more.
It's called www.opportunities4Atlanta. So opportunitiesforatlanta.com. The very first thought of it came last year. I was listening to the radio and individuals were calling in the last week of school or the week after APS, Atlanta Public Schools, let out. They didn't know what to do with their child. They didn't know where their child was going to go for the summer.
Opportunities for Atlanta offers parents a host of resources that range from finding quality summer camps to downloading free computer apps that offer educational enrichment to a list of internships for high school and college age students. Councilmember Dickens says the goal of the website is to offer one-stop shopping that provides educational and employment access to all families across the City of Atlanta.
We're not trying to reinvent the wheel. We're just trying to tell you, there's a wheel over here, there's a wheel over there, there's a wheel. And maybe that will lead people to be able to make proper choices about what to do with their family, what to do with their, you know, jobs and businesses. And I think that that way we grow.
For more information on the program, visit opportunitiesforatlanta.com. Councilman Dickens refereed the Southern Fried Kickin' Kickball Tournament. Southside team celebrated a day of music, food, snow cones, and of course, bragging rights. The teams were schools, civic organizations, local businesses, and neighborhoods. Guess who kept score?
There are 12 teams, so 12 neighborhoods have come together with kickball teams. Today is the tournament, and I am one of the official scorekeepers.
The event was sponsored by the South Atlanta Civic League, a group of South Atlanta residents who came together many years ago to improve the neighborhood and build the community.
Each year they do this, and it's awesome. It's a great way to get communities together, community versus community, but it's all in good spirit, all in good fun. Kids are out here, parents are out here, businesses are out here.
What we're trying to do here in the South Atlanta community is just bring the neighbors together and really help build relationships, help everybody get to know each other.
Congratulations to the winners, the Ron Clark Academy. We Cycle Atlanta hosted the Do the Bike Thing launch party, where they celebrated the teamwork put into the Ashview Heights Community Garden. Having the urban garden encourages residents to engage with neighbors.
We're playing in the dirt and getting out on bicycles and just doing community. This is real community in action. We got to present to one of the founders in 1995, a man named Mr. Abinsett founded this urban garden, and now Sean and his crew are keeping it going. And so we're seeing generational passing down of know-how, skills, but love for your neighborhood.
It was also the kickoff of Indiegogo.
Really, it's a program designed to get more youth on bikes, and they can earn those bikes through community service, working in the garden.
We Cycle Atlanta revitalizes communities by supporting health and wellness, environmentalism, and economic development through biking, research, and fellowship. Councilman Dickens left his car at home and rode his bike to work. Dickens participated in National Bike to Work Day. He began his bicycle commute at 8:30 from his house and took the 6.4-mile trek to his Georgia Tech office. Later that day, he biked another 6.9 miles over to Atlanta City Hall. Many Atlanta cyclists rode into work that day, reducing the city's use of fossil fuels and enjoying a healthy outdoor activity. And just in time for summer, some Beecher Hills Elementary School students got free bicycles. But before they could pedal away, the kids had a three-day bicycle safety training seminar, courtesy of Council Member Keisha Bottoms and the Atlanta Bicycle Coalition. Students with perfect attendance and good grades got bicycles as a reward.
Next to Beecher Hills Elementary School is the Southwest Connector Trail for the Atlanta Beltline. Just a great opportunity for the kids to go out and enjoy the Beltline and get their families out, and just a nice reward just for being such great students.
APD gets a visit from some Israeli police officers, and the Department of Public Works gets millions of dollars to make improvements around the city. That's next. A memorial run held in honor of a former Public Works Deputy Commissioner brought out hundreds of walkers and runners. The Dexter C. White Memorial 5K Walk Run started out at City Hall, the spot where White, a fitness enthusiast, often began his daily run. He passed away in November, and his death left a void in the lives of his family and co-workers.
We have city workers here. We have folks from other counties and other jurisdictions, as well as Mr. White's family. And of course, Public Works is here today. So when he passed away, Public Works wanted to find a way to honor him. And we came up with the idea to have this walk in his memory and in his honor.
Atlanta Fire Rescue holds its own memorial service every year to honor members who have passed away. The yearly tradition is also a time for a firefighter's family to remember their loved ones. Retired Fire Rescue member Gene Cornett died in December. He served with the department for nearly 30 years as an inspector and firefighter. His widow was at the memorial.
He always loved these memorial services. His sons would sing, and I would come and sit here with him, and they'd call these names and ring the bell. And I thought one day I may have to experience that, but I wasn't looking forward to it. But this is a beautiful place, and he loved the fire department.
For the Cornettes, the annual Firefighters Memorial was a family affair.
I've sang at these many a time with the mayor, all the time with my father. We would always sing. They'd always call us, and we would sing the songs and, you know, hear the bells ring for other people, and it was touching for them.
The Cornettes keep his memory alive by prominently displaying his Atlanta Fire Rescue uniform in the family's home. The Atlanta Police Department and the Atlanta Police Foundation recently hosted four members of the Israel National Police Department. The officers were in the States to compare best practices with Atlanta's finest.
There are different structures because Israel is a centralized national police, so you have one police force over the entire country. It's 28,000 officers. But policing is policing, and the issue is how do you focus on providing better services to the community and how you create and maintain a top-notch professional police force.
In addition to the typical challenges any police force faces, Israeli police also have terrorism, but they say they ultimately have the same concerns as Atlanta police officers.
Even though we're dealing with a lot of terror, to not forget that our main commitment is to serve the people, the citizens, and to make them feeling more safe on the daily basis.
The visit is part of the Atlanta Police Leadership Institute, which focuses on identifying and developing future APD leaders. A new development on the Atlanta streetcar is energizing fans of the project. The overhead power cables that will bring the streetcars to life have been turned on. The lines carry 750 volts of direct current, and streetcar officials are warning people that even though the power lines are overhead, they can still be dangerous.
These lines carry a lot of electricity through them, and so we need to treat them with great respect. Stay away from them, don't climb the poles, don't throw things over them, do not touch the wires under any circumstances.
Gavin says you can expect to see streetcars out and about during the testing phase later this month. Public Works Commissioner Richard Mendoza accepted a grant on behalf of the city from Governor Nathan Deal. The $4 million grant will be used to make improvements to parts of Martin Luther King Jr. Drive, as well as pedestrian improvements to areas around the Capitol, the Fulton County Government Center, and City Hall. Mendoza says Atlanta is also planning to convert traffic lights throughout the city to LEDs, which will save the city money in energy costs. Atlanta Beltline officials estimate that 10,000 people a day utilize the East Side Trail on the weekends, and 2,000 to 3,000 people use it on weekdays. Over the course of the year, the Atlanta Beltline is estimated to have 1 million people using the East Side Trail. And the Beltline Southwest segment has received another funding boost. The James M. Cox Foundation donated a $5 million grant to the Beltline. The grant will be used towards construction of the trails on the west side, which will cost $43 million.
The West Side Trail project is really going to be a game changer for Atlanta, and for specifically for Southwest Atlanta. And this is not the first time that the Cox Foundation or Jim Kennedy have stepped up. Jim Kennedy and his wife Sarah Kennedy donated $2.5 million to the development of the East Side Trail, and we are all extremely grateful for their support. We could not do it without them.
Since the first stretch of trails opened back in 2012, the Atlanta Beltline Project has received numerous local, regional, and national awards. Now the development of the Beltline is receiving international recognition. The International Real Estate Federation recognized the Atlanta Beltline as the best environmental rehabilitation project in the world. The Federation says the East Side Trail and historic Fourth Ward Park embodies excellence in all real estate disciplines. Lauded for sustainability and humanity, the Grand Prix Excellence Award was presented to the Atlanta Beltline in the European country of Luxembourg.
It's a really, really amazing honor to have the Atlanta Beltline recognized on an international stage for the work that we're doing here in Atlanta. They were looking at transformation. I think they were looking at specifically environmental cleanup and creating a healthy environment out of what was previously a very unhealthy environment. And the resulting revitalization in the neighborhoods as a result of these projects, the new housing that has been built, the new businesses that have come and opened up alongside of each of these new public spaces.
The Atlanta Jazz Festival was a blast, and now we leave you with this.